Why'd you guys get so quiet all of a sudden?
Hey, Merry Christmas, everybody. Are you guys awake? Are we awake this morning? Hey, Merry Christmas. No, let's try again. Merry Christmas. Okay, here we go. You guys ready? Hey, Keith, we were just waiting. I was stalling for Keith.
To get here.
The singers this morning, our band name is Four Wise People. We're very glad to be here this morning. It's okay. It's okay, McKay. Okay. See, I did people, though. Okay, you guys ready to go?
Ready? Go ahead.
Can you stand as we worship this morning?
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive of thee. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing.
Checking in here to the one church service with Good Fight. Hold on. Sharing that live stream. All right, there we go. Good job. All right, you can be seated. Welcome to this one church, one Christmas joint service with Canadian Valley Baptist Church and Good Fight Church. It is absolutely a pleasure, and I'm so go ahead and clap. Yeah. We had a great night last night. Who was here last night? There we go. I'm not going to ask who wasn't here last night because I don't want to bring anybody, call anybody out. But man, if you missed last night, you missed something. But I am so glad that you're here because we are going to have a great service. We've been planning this this weekend together for a couple months now. Good Fight in our church, and we have worked together. We've collaborated. We have joined together, and this team up here leading worship. It's awesome how God can bring folks together, different styles, different backgrounds, different things that we're used to, and come together for a beautiful, joyful noise. And that's what we're going to do. That's what you all are doing as you're sitting there. You're making a joyful noise to the Lord, and we are celebrating together what Christmas is all about. It's our privilege to have John Phipps be preaching here in a little bit. He is the lead pastor at Good Fight Church. My name's Cameron Whaley, for all of you Good Fighters that don't know me. I am the lead pastor here at Canadian Valley, and man, it's a joy. Couple things. Last night we took up an offering, and that offering went to Gateway Women's Resources in UConn. We're going to do the same thing again this morning. We're going to pass the plate at the end of the service. Us Baptists, we like to pass the plate. So we're going to do that, and all the money that's collected this morning will go to the Gateway Women's Resources, and so we encourage you to give generously in that regard. Also, for any of you, and if you want to write, because I didn't see any of the Good Fight Church, but if you are here and you're a guest with us, we would love for you to grab one of these Connect cards. Good Fight's got Connect cards too. These are in the chair backs around you. If you pull one of those out, there's an opportunity for you to write, fill out your information, for you to write who you are, where you're from. Also on the back, this is where it becomes most important, and this is something that John touched on last night, is on the back there are opportunities for us to connect with you in ministry or in prayer requests. If you have a need in your life, fill that out. Put that in the offering plate at the end of our service, and we will get that to the right place. We will pray over those prayer needs, and we will follow up with you. Let me pray with us as we begin this worship this morning and as we continue on. But man, I am just so glad to be joining with you together to celebrate Christmas this year. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for all that you do. Lord, we exalt your name, the name which is above all names, the name of Jesus Christ, who, as the angel told Joseph, name him Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. And that's why we are here. That's what we are about. And so as we gear up and go into Christmas morning tomorrow, let us treasure all of these things in our heart just as Mary did, and let us exalt and proclaim the name of Jesus at every opportunity. May today, Canadian Valley fade away, Good Fight Church fade away, and may you be exalted so that the name of Jesus Christ would be proclaimed. Lord, thank you so much for all that you do. It's in Jesus Christ's name that we do pray. Amen. Let's worship.
All right. Hadn't you wondered what wonderful sound it must have been when the angels sang when Jesus was born? Let's stand together and sing and remember that as we glorify the birth of our Savior together as we sing. All right?
Time we're going to have the privilege to partake of the Lord's Supper together, communion. That opportunity where we stop, we remember what Jesus Christ has done for us. We're going to take of the bread, and the bread means that Jesus Christ sacrificed his body on the cross for us. We're going to take the cup, grape juice, and it represents the blood that Jesus poured out. Scripture tells us that if there is no shedding of blood, there can be no remission of sins. And so we have that. Jesus had his disciples in that upper room the night before his crucifixion, and he instituted this. And then Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 says, as often as you can, get together and remember and do this in this way. And so we're going to do it as one church this morning. We're going to have six men. And men, why don't you go ahead and come forward? These men are going to be at six different places around this room. And we're going to do this a little different than maybe you're used to. But we're going to ask you to come up in groups of families, you and a friend, by yourself if you'd like. And then you're going to take of the bread and the cup here with these men, and then they're going to pray over you and worship with you in that way. And let them do that. Let them bless you. It's a humbling thing, but it's also a very God-honoring thing, and especially this Christmas. As we put our focus on Jesus, we've also got to remember that Jesus Christ died on the cross for our sins and sacrificed himself. I want to pray over this whole time. Also, I want to kind of step outside of this moment. And John, where are you at? Come on up here, John. I want to pray for John's family. John and Christy and their son Jonah have been dealing with some illness. Jonah's up here. Christy wasn't able to be here last night because of Jonah's illness. He's been in the ER. And I want to pray for you guys. I want to pray for this time. And pray for this sweet little guy that's just not doing well. So let me do that, and then we're going to have this. We got the piano's going to be playing, and then you just come and make your way through. Let me pray for you guys. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you so much for John and Christy and for their leadership in this church and for their friendship, and we've been able to collaborate on several different things and just see how you work in their lives, Lord. And I know the heartache and the challenge right now as they're dealing with the with a little one, Jonah, who's not doing well, has had a fever off and on, maybe dealing with some dehydration, and Lord, you know the ins and outs of what's going on there. And Lord, we just come to you, the healer, the creator, and the one who desires a relationship with each one of us, and we ask that you would be with this young man and give him healing, give him peace during this time. Lord, help John as he is occupied by the thoughts of his family, but also occupied by the thoughts of the message that he will be preaching. Lord, help him not to separate those two, but to do both of them very well, and to make sure that you are, which I know he does, Lord of his life and of his family. Lord, I pray for this this precious family right now. Lord, I pray for this time of the Lord's Supper. Lord, as we gather and as we partake of it, Lord, let us keep our eyes on you. This Christmas, as we gather and give gifts, let us keep our eyes on you and what your coming to earth meant. It meant that a sacrifice that was sufficient for us was finally available. Lord, thank you for this time. It's in Jesus Christ's name that I do pray this. Amen.
Thank you. to suffer, born to save, born to raise us from the grave. Christ the everlasting Lord, he shall reign forevermore. Noel, Noel, come and see what God has done. Noel, Noel, the story of amazing love, the light of the world given for us. Noel.
Good morning. Okay, before we get started, we're going to have to get a little bit more lively than this. So if you haven't met someone close to you, I'd like for this moment just to say welcome home to someone, welcome to church, Merry Christmas, someone you don't know real quick. Hey, Cody, can we get the lights changed? All right. Hey, I'm not used to preaching on Sunday morning. Here's how it usually goes on Sunday nights is, like, I'm telling everyone, you got to get a little more rowdy than this. After all, we're responding to God's identity. So this is the same rules as Saturday night. I'm going to go ahead and clap for that. I know it's Christmas Eve and it's Christmas service, but here are a couple things I want you to know. When you walked in, whether you heard someone say welcome home or not, at our church we always say welcome home. And here's the reason why, is because I believe that this building is just that you're the church, that people come here, individuals don't come here to worship God individually. That individuals come here to worship God collectively as a family. So today, just go ahead and get settled in that we're family. We're gonna say some things that are gonna be a little, it's gonna be testing to your heart today. I want you to drop the pride, because this is a story that we've all heard growing up, or you've probably read it several times getting to today, and I know you're like, I've got places to go, people to see, things to cook, but just in a few minutes, all right, and just in a few minutes. So today as I start to speak, I just want you to know to allow God to just allow this message to permeate a little bit so it can penetrate, and it can really be there for the rest of the day and the rest of the season. So if I haven't met you yet, my name is John. I'm the lead pastor of the Good Fight Church. Cameron, you and Shannon, I'm just completely honored that you allow us to occupy your space every single Saturday night. I am completely honored to share the stage with you and your family. I just want to start off by saying that you guys have a special pastor, and that if you're not encouraged by that, you should be. He's a great guy, a great family. Also, I want you to know, if you don't have a Bible, there should have been one on the end of your row. If there wasn't, that's okay. Before today, before you leave, go get one at the sound booth. We'll make sure you have one. And also, if you don't have one, but you want one, go ahead and pull out your smart device. I know we have the Bible app downloaded, or the Good Fight Church app, or one of the many apps that has the Bible for free. Go ahead and get those out. We will be in the Bible. We're going to land, just like Cameron was in the Word last night, in Luke 2, verses 8 through 14. We'll be jumping around a little bit. Don't worry, every bit of Scripture will be up here on stage. So as you're turning to Luke, I want to go ahead and read Isaiah 9:6. Isaiah 9:6. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. This is foretelling the arrival of Jesus. And just as we've been celebrating the last 3 weeks at our church, we've been in Advent. We've been observing and reflecting and remembering the arrival of Jesus in the hope, the love, the joy, and in today, peace. And that's where we're going to set most of all, is peace, because I don't know about y'all, but after I leave here, we begin what we call the Phipps Family Tour. And that means we're going to go from place to place to place. Usually here's how it goes, is as soon as we get done with whatever we're doing on Christmas morning, we go to my mother-in-law's house, and we do that until about 2:45 or 3, and then from 3 we go to my sister's house, and we spend the rest of the night with my family. Then we get up, and we kind of reverse a little bit, and we go eat lunch with my mother, and then we go over to her mother's house, and then on Tuesday we go to her father's house. And some of you are sitting there going like, big deal, I got like 15 grandmothers, and I got like 15 uncles, and you're like, that's just kind of normal. But that's how it is in my life, and it doesn't just begin on Christmas Eve, but more or less it begins back in November. As soon as Thanksgiving is over, we're in a culture or a society that tells us, go, 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 do, 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 bye, bye, bye. And it starts this wave of chaos and noise and distractions. And I'm going to tell you what, it's noisy. It's noisy, and some of you are sitting here right now and you haven't even let this sink in yet. You're not even settled in yet because you're still thinking about what we're about to go do, about what we're about to go cook and entertain. And so just let this set in a little bit and think about this. Is your life busy? Is your life noisy, especially during this season? Because I tell you what, one thing the devil is banking on is this time of year to get you blinded by all the distractions of this world. And we start to lose focus of what Isaiah 9:6 truly means and what it says about he is a wonderful counselor, that he is a mighty God, and more importantly, he is the Prince of Peace. And that's the main point that we're going to sit in today. And we're going to define this real quick because I think it's important to understand what that Prince of Peace actually means before we go on this trek of peace in our hearts. And so it was written as Prince of Peace. The Hebrew word would have been prince, would have been czar. It means the one in charge. And oftentimes, I think we get this confused, that we think of the word prince and we think of this person that is underneath the headship of a king that has not really much responsibility and is even going to be married to the pretty girl of the kingdom. And we don't realize that it actually means in this translation, as we don't give it due justice here, is that it means the one in charge, general, chief, the one that makes things happen. Czar. In fact, the Romans would change that word later to Caesar. And that's the kind of power that this one word has, czar. Now, the last word of that, Prince of Peace, is shalom. That's something we're probably a little more familiar with, and it actually means rest. It means contentment. It means complete tranquility. So peace, it means rest. It's super important that we understand this, because as we go through today's sermon, we probably need to reflect back on this. Because today, in the last 3 weeks, everything should be about reflecting of who Jesus is. He is the Prince of Peace. He is the one in charge, and he is the one that gives rest. I mean, after all, that's why we observe Advent in different churches. It's not so we can get ready for Christmas, but to get ready for Christmas in reflecting, remembering, and resetting our hearts to what the season is all about, because it is noisy, it is busy, and a lot of us are going, hurry up, I hope he doesn't preach longer than 15 minutes, we've got to go. Because we lose focus, and it often turns into a season where anxiety starts to get high. and stresses start to build. And what happens is we start to compromise our future because we need immediate relief for today. And I call it temporary happiness. And what I mean by this is, because you're like, is that really, I mean, come on, that's a little bit of a stretch, but think about this, is it starts even a few months ago, and what we do is we decide that, you know what, I would rather go ahead and give in to the distractions, give in to the noise, and just go ahead and pay for all these gifts, because it seems like, I don't know about y'all, but it seems like every year's got to get bigger and better, and we've just set that standard of that's normal in our society, they just give in to that. They say, look at this deal, come here, buy this, do that. Invite people here, and every year becomes almost a building block for the next year. And instead of giving into the Prince of Peace, what we do is we give into our emotions, and we base our decisions on emotion rather than peace. And when I say this, it gives us temporary relief for disaster tomorrow. It's because we buy today for something that we can't afford to pay later. Or we eat for the struggles of our weight tomorrow. Or even worse is that we bottle up our emotions and say something because of the drunk uncle that did something on Thanksgiving, and no one wants to talk about it. And so we bottle up our emotions for whatever that looks like in your life, and then that just causes, it comes out in other areas of your life later on. Maybe with your family, or with your coworkers, or your friends, and you're wondering, what's going on? Where did this coming from? Well, it's coming from because we wanted more temporary happiness than we wanted sustained peace. And don't get me wrong, because I know you're like, who's this guest pastor coming over here talking this noise? And I'm not suggesting that we, because I'm not just talking to you, I'm talking to my own heart. I'm talking to my own heart, and I'm not suggesting that you've forgotten who Jesus is. I'm not. But we've become so distracted, and we lose focus, and then we're left wondering later on, what happened? Because January is going to hit, and we're going to look at the bank account and go, oh. We're going to look at our phone when our family calls and go, I just spent time with them. We're going to look at our waistline and go, how did I get here? You know, we're going to say things like, why and how did things get so crazy? And I believe this is the reason. It's because we want the peace. We want the peace, but we don't want the lordship. Okay? We want the peace, but we don't want the lordship. We want the Savior, but we don't want the czar. I want the peace, but I want to do it my way. You see where it's coming from here? The Prince of Peace, we want the peace part, but what we don't want is to walk completely picking up our cross daily. This is not a seasonal thing for the Christers, for the people that just attend on Christmas and Easter. I'm talking to every one of us. It's picking up our cross daily and saying that it's not just about the peace, but it's also underneath the lordship of our Jesus Christ. That's what today is about. So when we're going and we leave here and that noise hits and that chaos hits in your life, listen, don't jeopardize your future for temporary happiness today. I mean, and here's a good example of this. It's like, yeah, but I know Jesus. And so here's an example is you watch the weather all week long. We knew it was going to be bad weather. So just say you're watching the weather. You know it's going to be raining, but you got to go out into the world. So what you do is you grab your umbrella. You go to the mall to get all your gifts or wherever it is you go. You get out of your car. You run inside. You got your umbrella with you. And then you come back outside. You still have your umbrella with you. You get into the car, and you're completely wet. And you look at your umbrella and go, why didn't you protect me? It's because some of us are not walking underneath the protection of our umbrella and still wondering why we're getting wet. And that's what it's like. It's like, I want the peace of your protection, umbrella, but yet I don't want to open you up and have to do the things that it actually takes to walk underneath your protection. You want the Savior, but you don't want the czar. Ask yourself this, are you prepared to change the way we think? Are you prepared to start walking underneath the lordship of Jesus Christ? Because it's different. It's not just about having the peace, but it's about having the protection of our Lord and Savior. And part of this is pride. Because this is how it is. Every single year I seem like, man, I got to preach on this again. It's really hard to preach the same message over and over. Here's the deal. It's not. That's my pride swelling up. And if you're sitting there going today, I wish you'd stop talking because I got to go. Maybe we should adjust our hearts and our minds and ask ourselves, why are we really here? I started studying this months ago, and I started reading. I was like, how am I going to communicate this? Like, is this the way to go? Because it's a little offensive. I mean, if you're not used to it, and you got someone that's, and especially standing next to Cameron always makes me realize how light my voice is. You know what I mean? Because he's like belting out powerful tunes, and I'm like, I sound like a 14-year-old girl. You know, so as I'm studying for this, I'm praying, like, how is this going to go about? And I started thinking about in my own life is, what does it look like in my life with the czar and the protection of his lordship? And I sit there and I say, well, I preach and I pastor and I do all these things and I got it all figured out, and I don't. But what a lot of us do is we want that peace, and then basically what it comes down to is, man, you could have peace riding shotgun with you buckled up in your car, but if you're not willing to listen to the co-pilot, you're going to get lost. And it reminded me of the story of Mary and Martha, Lazarus' sisters. And go ahead, in Luke 10, 38 through 42, it should be up here, don't worry about turning to it. It says, now as they went on their way, Jesus entered a village, and a woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his teachings. You know what she was doing? She was dwelling in the presence of the Lord. She wasn't caught up with anything else. She said, the Lord is here, and here I am. But Martha, and see if you can relate to this, because this is where I'm at most Christmases, but Martha was distracted by much serving. Got to do this, got to get here, got to buy this, got to get it done, got to call this person, got to make sure everything is perfect along the way. I know none of us can relate to that. And she went up to him and said, Lord, do you not care that I am doing all this while she's just sitting there? I mean, I'm part of a lot of environments that do this. I wish they would just do something. I mean, even in our own church, we talk about all the time, it's like, quit getting in groups, let's go out and talk to people. Simple things like that. And here Martha is going, what about me? I am doing all this for you. But Jesus said this, Martha, Martha, Martha. He said, Martha, seriously, you are full of anxiety and you're troubled about many things, but one thing is necessary. And he's talking right here about what Mary's. Hey, one thing is necessary. You need to learn how to dwell in my presence. It says, Mary has chosen the good portion, which will not be taken away from her. And that's the great news. When you sit and you fully immerse your heart and your life into Jesus, you can sit at the feet of Christ and you can have that peace that passes and surpasses all understanding. And you don't get worked up about, hey, are we going to be on time? Where do we need to be? Who do we need to see? And the season changes from a season to a lifestyle. And our heart gets adjusted. Let me ask you, are you Mary or are you Martha this Christmas season? I see people laughing, amen, because I know that it hits home. Which one are you? Because peace is ours to have. This is the good news part of the message. Peace is ours to have. But here's the catch. Our world will try to sell you on their peace. Take these pills and you will feel better. And I'm not suggesting that you should get off your medication if you are. There are doctors for good reason. But are you taking those because you don't know any other way? The world will say, drink this. Shop here, shop more. Buy this, buy that. And by this, it's telling you that you will be fulfilled. Your jobs, gifts, etc. But here's the thing about Christians. Here's the thing if you're a follower. It is not a process. Peace is not a process. Peace is a person. I'm going to say that again. Peace is not a process, but peace is a person. Are you searching for it in other ways? Go ahead, clap for that. Are you searching for it in other ways? Here's what Ephesians 2, 13 and 14 says. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. See, it is about his blood, not about our process. For he himself is our peace. See, he is peace. He gives peace, but he is peace. who has made us both one and who has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility. If I were to go out and poll most people during the year, I'd say, well, what is peace? And they might say something along, it's like getting out of our problems. Getting out of our problems. And a lot of us, is that's where that temporary happiness is coming from, is if we can just get through these next few hours, next few days, everything will be better. Yet, a month from now, remember, we're going to be going, where did all of our money go? Why am I not talking to my sister? Why am I about to lose my job? What's going on? And the reason why is because peace isn't the absence of something. It's the presence of someone. All right, someone clap. Let's clap for that right there. That's the point. At my church, we're going to clap a lot because we're gonna get excited about this. Is peace isn't the absence of something. It's the presence of someone. So today, it's really about Christmas story. I know that's a lot just to set this up. But I think it's important to understand the czar and the shalom, under walking under the lordship of Jesus Christ and actually receiving the peace of Jesus. So how did this happen? Let's look at the Christmas story to remind us. Let's look at the story of hope, of joy, of love, and peace in Luke 2, verses 8 through 14. It said, "And in the same reason there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over the flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone all around them." That word glory, real quick, I just want to touch on that. In the original manuscript, it would have been translated as kavod. And it actually means the full weight of someone's presence. Because I picture in my mind, it's like just this bright light. And it says, I'm talking about the gravity of the situation is so impressive, you have no choice but to go tremble and shake. And something big is happening here. It says the Lord shone all around them, and they were filled with great fear. I tell you what, sometimes we get so caught up in what's going on by the distractions of us, is when we do get a glimpse of God in our life, it scares us. And the reason why is because it reminds us of how far we've truly stepped away from that czar. The good news is, He came here to give you great joy, to give you great hope, and it's through His blood and through His resurrection that all you have to do is take one step back underneath His grace. And in verse 10 it says, "And the angel said to them, fear not, don't be afraid." A couple weeks we talked about this phrase. It's actually used over 350 times in the Word. It's a command. It's a command, and when I hear it, I thought to myself, just another thing we got to do. But we shouldn't look at this as a command. When they say, don't be afraid, why do you think it's said so many? There's no other command in the Bible that's used more frequent than do not be afraid. And I use the example of whenever your child or friend or someone that you know is completely scared. I use the example of my daughter having a nightmare. And I walk into a room, I don't like go, hey, stop it, don't be afraid, and walk off. No, what I do is I sit down beside her. And I listen to her, and I caress her, and I hold her, and I love her, and I say, don't be afraid, baby. And it's not my words or my commands that mean something, but it's my presence. And it's more like an invitation than it is a command. And I ask you this, whenever you're afraid and you can hear the whispers of Jesus saying, do not be afraid. Don't look at it as something I've got to do, but look at it as, thank goodness I can be in the presence of a God that loves me so much. He's willing to sit down one-on-one with me and to say, my presence is so much greater than my words. Where are you today? Are you feeling invited? For behold, I bring you good news, great joy that will be for all. Some of you right now go, that's not for me. It is for you. It is for you, and that's great news. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you, and you will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with an angel a multitude of heavenly praising God and saying, glory to the God in the highest and on earth, peace among those with whom He is pleased. So how do we get this? We have to have a little bit of practical application for the holidays. So when we go out and we go back into the noise and the craziness, that we can say, you know what, let's just think about this. We're going to keep it simple because there's a lot of ways. But today, how do we get peace? It starts with this. It starts with faith. It starts with faith in Jesus Christ. Let's look at Romans 5:1 and what it says. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace. We have peace with God through Lord Jesus Christ. Now, there are over 790 places in the Bible that it talks about peace. 790. So today, we're going to go ahead and cover 790. I'm kidding. Hey, you're like, hey, I'm about to lose all peace right now. Let's go. 790, but here's what peace is talking about in three different ways. It's the peace with God, spiritual. And it's the peace of God that's with ourselves. And then the last one is relational, peace with others. Now we're going to focus about what it just said, peace with God, because if you don't have peace with God, you're not going to have peace of God, and you're certainly not going to have peace of others. And I'd ask you, where in your life do you need peace? Is it in your relationship? As I say, I will look at every bad part of my life, and this is what I need to do, is sit down and go, where am I struggling? Where am I hurting? Where am I falling short? And that's where I need the presence of Jesus. Because it starts with His presence, it starts with the presence and peace with God before you can have the peace of God. And without the peace with God, there won't be peace internally or externally. But there is great news. There's great news because some of you are like, I haven't sniffed, felt, seen peace in a long time. And you're like, hey, I have done so many terrible things. Or maybe some of you are just feeling guilt and shame and conviction of the things that you haven't spoken about that you have done. And the good news is this, is that no matter what you've done or what you're doing, that peace cannot be earned by that. It can't. It's through a person. And it's what Jesus did on the cross for us. And that's what Christmas is about, to realize, to remember and reflect that this peace is only done through Him on that. Not by your actions, not by what you can do. And there is no exception to that rule. There's none. In fact, the scripture that we just read, it said it's for all people, even the lowly, even the ones that where I've been so many times where I feel like I am the worst of the worst of the worst. How can I experience peace? And honestly, whenever I get to my bottom and I'm broken, all I really want is for the noise to stop. That's what Jesus offers you. And you can't do anything. He does it for you. Let's look at Hebrews 7. It says, unlike other high priests, and they're talking about the authority of Jesus, and they're talking about, hey, here's what sets Jesus apart from your other priests, because He is the high priest. Unlike the other high priest, He does not need to offer sacrifices day after day for His own sins and then for the sins of the people. He sacrificed for their sins once. Just once. Think about that. Whenever you're miserable and you're wondering how did it get so noisy, how did things get so bad, it just takes one decision for you. He's already done the work. Quit thinking, I got to go do this, got to do a book study, I got to get in a group, I got to checklist, checklist, checklist. That's noise, that's chaos. It starts with a heart transformation. And it starts with accepting Him into your heart. And I promise this, and in those 790 verses, God has a peace for every one of your problems. Every one of them, because you're like, you don't understand what you're going through. I may not, but He certainly does. There is nothing too big, too bad for our God, for our Lord of Lords. So how do we sustain this? How do we sustain this? Because this is really the solution right here. This is the solution to all the noise and the chaos. Let's look at Philippians 4, verses 6 through 7. And Paul wrote this. He said, don't be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication. What is supplication? I read that, I go, what is that? And all it really means is to humbly, in humility, to ask God, to request something from God. That might be key in our lives right there. Think about that. Are you walking in humility? It says, through prayer and humility, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, see, when you have the peace with God, you can have the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus, which gives me great joy, because you mean I don't have to focus on that daily? I can focus on just picking up my cross, because whenever you're submersed and immersed in the full presence of God, He will guard your heart and your mind. So after I read that, are you going to worry or are you going to worship? Are you going to worry or are you going to worship? Are you going to panic or are you going to pray? How am I going to get out of this? Listen, don't start after the fact. It starts back in July and June. It starts way before this season. And I look at it like this. I'm an old military guy, so I like these analogies with war and soldiers. I can get it. It's like, did you know that the best soldiers have peace? The best soldiers, they do. They have peace not after the battle, but during the battle. And the reason why is because they're prepared. Every single day they wake up and they get prepared for what might happen. It's the ones who aren't prepared that all they do is they make the decision that comes right in front of them and they panic. Because now they've allowed their emotions to start dictating their future. Rather than the preparation and the picking up of the cross, they get emotional, they say things, they do things, and they act a certain way based on emotion rather than a person. And the crazy thing is, it doesn't matter the outcome. The soldier knows they have a job to do. And it doesn't matter the destination. They know where they're headed. And as followers of Jesus Christ, we know where we're headed. Who are you grabbing along the way to show them this is how it's done? Because today is not about us. Every day is not about us. It's really about the glorification of Jesus in all things we do. When we get together, it's not about us. This shouldn't be a place where you come and like, oh, I got to get my head right for the one day of the week. This should be a place where I get to see my family hang out and I get excited about what's to come this week. So I can go out and show the glorification of our Lord Jesus Christ and to show people the peace that surpasses all understanding. It doesn't come from a Sunday. It doesn't come from a Saturday. What it does, it comes from the heart. And what does your heart truly look like? Are you dwelling in the presence of Him? What I do is, during the season, I find myself doing things that I normally don't do. Like, I pray at the end of the day. Like, that's normal. But I find myself more frustrated. And the reason why is because I go through the, like, I gotta go, we gotta go, gotta go, gotta go, gotta go, gotta go. And we do all these things, and then at the end of the day, I'm like sitting there laying in bed going, oh, thank you, Jesus, for letting me get all this off my chest. But why do I wait till the end of the day? Do you wait till the end of the day to take your inventory? Why are you doing that? And we should be having these little prayers and these conversations with our Lord every single day, because if we want the peace with God, to get the peace of God, we've got to be communicating. And too many times I lay in bed and go, man, I barely made it through this one. Thank you. And I start thanking Him for things that He's saying, if you would have been communicating to me, maybe we could have taken care of this. I heard a pastor say a few months ago, and I love this analogy because I can relate to it. He said some of the most important prayers of his day, he calls them driveway prayers. He pulls up, and before he goes into the house with his wife and kids, he sits down and he says, God, please reset my heart. Please reset my heart. And I think this is so important for me because my wife doesn't know what's going on with everything I got to deal with during the day. And I don't need to take that into her. And here's the thing, I don't know if the kids have taken my wife hostage and are like running crazy in the house. And like if they're going to come up to me and stab me or if they're going to come up to me and hug me. And so as I'm sitting there in the garage and in my car, I need to be resetting and thanking God for what's happening instead of waiting to the fact when I go in and every like this chaos just jumps on me and I'm like, ah! And how many times in our life are we like that? We get home and we take it out on our spouse, on our families, because we've had a bad day. And we wait till the end of the day to start trying to get right with God. And what it does is before we start going marching into the fire, maybe we should take a little bit of time to humble ourselves before the flame. God, reset my heart. Nothing is too bad, too important to jeopardize my future with my family and the peace with You. Because of my emotions. And the one last thing I want to talk about on peace, and then we'll get out of here. The one last thing. If you want to sustain it, if you want it, here's what you have to understand. You have to expect Him to help you. Because I know a lot of us are going, I haven't heard from Him or seen Him in a long time. But it takes a little bit of action on our part. Let's look at Matthew 11, 28 through 30. Just think about this. How great is our God that He was born for this? So this moment right now that you could have your heart reset, because he's leaving it up to us to go out and take this good news. And here's what he says. He says, come to me. What? I got to go to you? Yes, he says, I'm here. Come to me. Come to me. I am so much greater. And I have to understand that I am so much less. He says, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Zar Shalom. I am your Lord. Come to me, and I will give you shalom. I will give you peace. I will give you rest. This is what I'm here for. He says, take my yoke. So not only come to me, but now you have to take. Reach out. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. What? I need a God that's humble and low in stature? Yes. Yes, you do. I do. And he says, you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Let me ask you, are you more tired right now than you've been in months? The day hasn't even started. The 2 days of Christmas Eve and Christmas, are you more tired right now? You're like, I don't know how I'm going to make it. He says, rest, peace, stop the chaos. This is what it is. It's an invitation. Just like he says, don't be afraid. And more or less, it's an invitation, and this is what Jesus is saying. I am here. Come to me. This is an invitation. No matter what you're going through, what you're struggling with, I am peace. And with me, you can have peace. And when you have that, I will give you the peace that you desire in your heart. And then he says, take my yoke. What is a yoke for? It's a big wooden slat. You put it on horses or oxen. And what it does is lightens the load. And they pull together. And what he's saying is like, come to me, take my yoke. What I'm going to do is I'm going to lighten your load. I don't know what's going on in your life, but Jesus is saying, I'm going to take part of that. And that should stimulate that peace. That should remind us that, you know what, it's not about us, but it's about him. The purpose of a yoke is to lighten the load. It is a partnership. Listen, if you want peace, here's the simplicity of it. You cannot have peace unless you have a relationship with God. Period. We have a God so big and so good that individually he wants to sit next to you and he wants to say, I want you, I have you, don't worry about it, come to me. Take my yoke upon you. So this Christmas, realize this, there is more to Christmas than stuff. All the presents, all the gifts, all the places, all the people. Don't let that ruin your heart for the true reason. I'm not saying you can't go out and celebrate and have a good time. That's what we should do. We should be celebrating with the people we love about the God that has given us sustainable life and his peace. Don't just go through the motions. Because right now we're going to have a chance. And I want us to humble ourselves. Walk in this attitude of humility for the rest of the year. Carry it forward. We're going to have an opportunity right now. Are you ready for that peace? Because I know right now, my wife just took my son to the emergency room. They went to Access Medical. And I'm sitting here, and I'm not worried. Am I concerned? Yeah, I'm concerned. But she knows, I know, you know that, you know what, the Word of God has something to tell us. And it's not, I don't believe it's just these people right here like, hey, we're broken. We are broken. But more importantly, we need to take this manuscript, we need to take this and take it home with us and throughout the season remind each other, this is why we're meeting together. This is why we have time off. This is why we have Christmas. This is why we have peace. If you're ready for your load to be light, if you're ready for just to re-energize and to remain, I'm going to invite you up right now. Pastor Cameron, if you'll come up here. Right now, I'll go ahead and ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes. And I want you to have an attitude of humility right now. I want you to understand that this is not about anyone else but your walk with Jesus Christ. If you're ready to make that decision today, if you're ready for your heart to change, I want you to just raise your hand. If you have fallen away from him and you're ready to come back to him, or you've never walked with him before, raise your hand and look at me. Amen, 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 right there. Who else? Don't walk into today into the fire without the peace of Jesus. as we pray together, I'm inviting any of you to come up here and get prayer with Pastor Cameron, with myself, or with any of our deacons and prayer team in the back. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the lives that you're going to change, the lives and the families that are going to go out and glorify you through peace with you, so you can give them peace in their hearts and to share with other people. Over the next few moments, God, I pray that hearts are being changed, that they're being penetrated, that your word is piercing them, and that people will realize that this season is about you. God, we ask all these things in your son's holy name. Amen. Just for the next minute or so, we're going to be up here. If you need prayer, come on up.
Peace is what we need. And I loved how John put that. We've got to put the lordship of Christ And we've got to get underneath that, and that's where we're going to find that peace. You do that this Christmas. We're going to continue to pray for your families that this Christmas, Jesus Christ is Lord. We want to take an opportunity to worship in another way that we do here at Canadian Valley Baptist Church. I know that you do it at Good Fight in a little different way, but that's through taking up an offering. And we already let you know this morning that that the offering that's taken up this morning is going to be going to Gateway Family Resources in Yukon, do some great work. We've had some folks from our church volunteer there at Gateway, and so we're eager to participate, and especially during Christmas. We've been given so much generously. Now we have an opportunity to also give generously. When we take up an offering, it's an opportunity for us to act out our faith. We say we trust the Lord. And now when we give, we're saying, hey, we trust the Lord even in this area as well. So I'm going to ask our men that are helping with our offering to come forward, and we're going to pass a plate. I'm going to pray for it, and then we're going to worship through collecting our offering. All right? Let me pray for us. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for our time here this morning. I pray that as we collect this offering, Lord, that we would be generous, that we would think of others, that we would understand all that you've done for us, and Lord, that you would just be glorified and honored in it. It's in Jesus Christ's name that I do pray. Amen. Amen. We're going to sing one more song here in just a second, but let me just say thank you so much to everybody from Canadian Valley and everybody from Good Fight for making this just an awesome Christmas. Thank you, Pastor John, for all of your work and your diligence in this, and the rest of the team for Kyle and Josh and Amy and everybody else, Tiffany and just all, Megan, Cody. Can't name all the names from Good Fight. And then our team for Keith, of course, and Jeremy and Tyler for all of his hard work, Nathan back there, and just all of the folks that we've got, Jennifer up here, that is doing so much to make this a great, great weekend. My prayer for you is that as you leave here, that you are amped up and ready for Christmas. Tomorrow is Christmas morning. Don't forget the gospel that we talked about last night. Don't forget the peace that we talked about this morning, and let's give God the glory for all that he deserves. Amen. Let's stand. We're going to sing a song.